You've been called anti-American.
Yes.
And some people also say you're anti-Israel.
Yes.
Now, with Rosewater coming out,
yes.
the Iranian regime says you're anti-Iranian.
Yes.
Which, to me, it seems like you're
Zionist.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Which, to me, it seems like you're pissing off all the right governments, and you must be doing something right. So what are you exactly?
I hope that I'm a comedian and a writer that is just trying to do have some sort of moral barometer in the work to expose what we think are absurdities or ridiculousness. And so, you know, in the Venn diagram, when they're calling you all those names, it only adds to that feeling of absurdity. So in some ways, it just sort of amplifies the work you're doing and what you think you're doing.
Absurdity. So in a story like about Iran, how do you find the truth? I mean, who decides what the truth is? And how do you find it?
Well, I don't. I mean, the other thing is I have to kind of own my inauthenticity. I'm not Iranian. So no matter what I do, it for someone who lives there, this will be a simplistic and reductive version of their life. But hopefully, from a Western performer, for a Western audience, it's a more nuanced look into a country that we've called evil. And, you know, if the dialogue between our two countries is, you're the axis of evil, well, you're the great Satan, that's a pretty reductive conversation. So anything I do, hopefully, will be a slightly more complex and nuanced version of that conversation. And hopefully, I think the film accomplishes that idea of showing that it's not so easy to dismiss it as one-dimensional parties going at each other, that there's a lot of complexity there. For me, the film is just a reflection of Maziar's book, which is, again, an interpretation of his experience. So within that, truth is probably a relatively elusive figure in all this, but I think the film is true to his reflection of his experience. And I think that's probably as close as I can get to what I wanted to achieve.
You were very sensitive about, you know, how Iranians would feel about this film, especially we've had experiences with, like, Not Without My Daughter and those sure. kind of negative films. How do you want this film to be received by Iranians inside and outside of Iran, knowing that right. obviously the Iranian government is not going to show this, so right. there's probably bootleg copies of it in Iran.
And right. knowing that they're not a monolith to begin with, that, you know, different. I think that's how I would like it to be received in the same way that almost any work is received anywhere, which is as a conversation starter, mm-hmm. as a point of reference to create a dialogue. You know, and there are moments within the film that I hope. You know, a Western audience might look at the character of Davood and say, you know, wow, I didn't realize, like, there's a guy I could see myself hanging out with. You know, it's a much more comfortable, you know, picture of an Iranian than I'm ever familiar with. But then maybe a more devout, you know, version of that individual in Iran might look at Ali Reza and say, oh, he was presented in the film as Western educated, he's from London, he's not some, like, robot spouting, you know, something fundamentalist. Davood is seen praying. You know, he's the only one in the film that's ever seen.
Kind of like Hangover. We all relate to somebody in
that's. I wanted this to be Hangover for Iranians.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Wait till the sequel comes out.
Oh, wonderful. I hope you don't make three at least.
Well, I got to see how many times Maziar can get arrested.
You know a lot about the region. You know a lot about the Iranian culture, so at least the Iranians think you do, you probably do. But what did you learn about yourself making this film about Iran as your first film and everything
right.
that's, you know, because it's a complicated country, it's a political mess, so what
yes.
what was it that you...
And not being able to be there, obviously, was difficult, because, again, you're another layer removed from a sense of authenticity, so I think we had to accept kind of that quiet inauthenticity that we were going to do. But living in Jordan for those months, and the Syrian civil war had broken out, and there was an awful lot going on in the region. And I think that, you know, it's difficult, because you have those moments of that kind of that maudlin, we're all one family of man. Don't we all just want the same things? And then you have other moments where you feel incredibly distant from the culture, and you feel like, man, that's a gap. I don't know that we can bridge, or that I don't see how this evolves. So I think it was a very complicated experience for me, one that was at times really optimistic, and then at other times just, you know, you sort of fall into a little sense of like, it's despairing.
So as someone who applies critical thinking to the great Satan,
yes,
also known as the United States, now crossing over to the axis of evil, formerly known as Iran,
yes,
what are the two similarities then between the two governments that you learned from this whole thing?
Well, I think that one is kind of a you know, America has its levers of power that it uses, but it's the ideal that it sets out to live up to. It's very reticent to ever admit to falling short of that. We're very big on that idea of we're awesome because we're awesome. You know, it's that manifest destiny, American exceptionalism, and any criticism of that is we're much more sensitive to it than you would imagine somebody that purports that awesomeness to be, you know, to own our own mistakes. You know, you have everybody, why is he making an apology tour? I feel like, I think part of the issue is there's less evil and malevolence in both environments than people are led to believe. Ignorance is epidemic, but evil is rare. And I think, you know, the more that we interact, the more that those become apparent, that those things become apparent, that it's less about malevolence. I don't think the United States is a malevolent figure. I don't think Iran is a malevolent figure. But there's a great deal of ignorance between both sides on how Iranians view the United States and how the U.S. views Iran.
I deal with a lot of trash mail every day, which I'm sure you're kind of used to.
I'm not familiar with that. You're saying that occasionally people will contact you and express displeasure.
Displeasure. That's the word. Yes, sir. So I try not to, you know, pay attention to it, but
stay out of the comments section.
I do. Yeah, but yeah. Sometimes you kind of have to figure out, you know, what's going
sure.
on. And you
maybe there's something constructive.
Exactly.
In this.
You always look for that constructive
sure.
stuff. Which happens sometimes, but it looks to me there are a lot of crazy irrational people justifying their crazy behavior based on like religious beliefs or something. They always have some kind of excuse to hide behind it.
Sure.
And say, well, you can't question it. It's definitely not irrational because if you read my book, you know,
it's dogma.
Sideways.
Sure.
Exactly.
It's infallible truth.
So, and it's the same case with ISIS right now and the same guy who was torturing Mazir. How do you deal with these people? Because you and I don't like violence.
Not a fan.
No. So, and the guys...
Not a fan of certainty, not a fan of violence. And they seem to go hand in hand.
So what do we do?
You do the most difficult thing you can do, which is take the long view. And that is, you know, and there's the sort of great quote that I come back to, which is the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And it's a continuum, and it's up and back. And I try and think of who we were as humans 100 years ago and the brutality that existed then. I think that the more exposure people get to each other, the less viable these types of really repressive, really violent regimes have. You know, I think we've seen, you know, colonialism be unsustainable, empire is unsustainable. And, you know, hopefully the more countries kind of become aware of that and become more rational actors that, but it's a long process. It'd be nice to say that 5 years from now it'd be, you know, but I don't think you can view it in those kinds of terms. I think you have to look at it on a much wider scale.
Yeah, it looks like we haven't changed a whole lot since 100 years ago this time.
It's funny, though, but I kind of, you know, I try and think about it like, okay, that was World War One, and in World War One, we were digging trenches and dropping mustard gas on each other. Now, we're still doing it, but it's an aberration now, and it's people do really try and control that through public opinion, through various things. That doesn't mean, I think we also have to lower our expectations to some extent.
I totally
as to
agree.
What, you know, lower your expectations. The world will never be a Coke commercial where we're all holding hands. And, you know, because at a certain point in that line, somebody would be like, I didn't get a Coke. Right. Oh, you did? Yeah, and that guy got two. So I think we're going to have to fight.
And that's kind of cool hearing that from you because a lot of people in the media think, like, oh, I can change the world and da-da-da-da-da-da. But, yeah, you got to lower
the expectations. There's, you know, perfection doesn't exist. And this right. is, And there are times when the world has to stand up. But I do think, I am optimistic that it improves incrementally at times, because I think we've seen it.
Sure. Why are dictators so afraid of comedy? Like, is comedy threatening?
Or news.
Tyranny or news? What's going on? Like, you know, with Bassem in Egypt.
I think it's crazy.
What the hell is going on?
Like, I don't know.
Is it more dangerous than the drones and the bombs? What's going on?
But even within that, in regimes where it's not threatened or in governments where it's not threatened, they always say to comedians, the question that is always asked to comedians is, where do you draw the line? What's too far?
Right. What is that line?
But what's crazy about that is they never ask that to the president or to senators.
Supreme leader.
Where do you draw the line? Is it torture? Is it waterboarding? But they always ask it of comedians, as though insult is somehow worse than injury. And I've never, that's really a fascinating question. I have no damn idea why that is. And it's such a projection of weakness when regimes feel threatened by, you know, hopefully one of the themes of the movies is that the apparatus that these governments build to suppress information is so far more damaging to their survival than any piece of information could ever be, that you know, that's kind of what you'd like them to take from it.
They lack common sense, it seems like, because if you know
what's... I feel like they lack confidence. Where's your confidence, Sisi? You're the leader, you're the pharaoh of Egypt.
Right.
Where's your confidence? Your confidence that someone could make jokes about you and you'd still be okay.
And that confidence or the insecurities show even more when you start seeing the guy's pictures all over the walls and the statues.
You're okay.
Yeah, right.
You know what you look like.
You just need a mirror.
You don't need to see it every 500 feet.
Right, right. The character in the movie and in the book, Rosewater. You know, to me what was funny was, and I totally expected it to be in the film, because when I was reading it, I'm like, this is funny. If I would make a film, I would definitely put this in there, and you did. What was his obsession with New Jersey while he's torturing Maziar? Now, you grew
paradise.
Up here. So, yeah, I was going to say, if he's definitely going to watch this thing.
It's
so
paradise.
It's paradise.
New Jersey's paradise. Everybody knows that. Why would Bruce Springsteen live in a place that wasn't paradise?
Bon Jovi?
Why would they live in a place that wasn't paradise?
It's better than New York?
It's a paradise.
Okay, so we're in the wrong city.
Well, New York's actually a pretty good city, too.
It's pretty good. But New Jersey?
The tri-state area is a paradise.
Okay.
He just wasn't aware of the Connecticut, New York, New Jersey connection.
Would you, if you hung out with him, what would you...
With Rosewater.
Where would you take him?
In New Jersey?
Yeah.
I'd take him to a massage parlor.
Can I come?
I would absolutely do that. Cool. Yeah, you can come with us. It'd be awesome. Side of a highway, massage parlor, and we'd probably go to, like, some dive bar.
Sweet.
I think part of it is he probably, you know... Because the diplomatic mission is located, you know, here, and people in New Jersey. I think that's why New Jersey, I think people, if you work in the security apparatus in Iran, you probably would know somebody who's been there.
Sure.
Or lived there. So I think that's where part of that obsession comes in.
Like, could have been worse. Could have been any other 50 state, far worse.
Exactly.
So New Jersey is actually pretty good.
Wyoming. But he really, the guy, as Mazar describes it, the guy really felt like New Jersey was this paradise on earth where everybody had sex all the time and there were no Jews, and it's this whole thing. And
you
just want to explain
it.
It's almost the opposite of what this guy thinks it is. It's all Jews and nobody has sex. It's really...
sex at all.
Yeah.
Besides making films about people that you accidentally put in jail, what other inspirations or what kind of other films would you like to make in the future?
That's a tough one. You know, I never view things as separate entities. I see it all as sort of a continuum of working. So I always just like to work, whether it be through, you know, kind of stand-up or doing the show or maybe a film or, you know, just a variety of ways to express ideas that you haven't done before or a little challenging or that sort of thing. The one thing I can promise you I won't do is cut an album. I think that...
Cut an album?
I will not cut an album.
Okay.
That's probably where I would...
Why is that?
Because I
can't sing.
There you go.
Okay.
And
all right.
Music
two of us.
It's all art and music, like, is magic to me. Like, I wish I could do that. If I could do that, I would not do this.
I got you.
If I could play guitar and sing.
Yeah, I've been following you since your MTV days. That's one
no
thing
guitar.
You definitely have not done.
No.
Huh.
Because I cannot.
You cannot.
Yes.
Now, I've been working in the media, or I think I have been since the mid-90s.
Yes, yes.
And I've seen a lot of dickheads in this field, okay? It's like, it's almost like, how do you, and you've been in this thing for a very long time, how do you keep that real? How is it that you'd never let it go, any of this distraction into your head? And you're generally a very cool person. Like, a lot of times when I'm doing something stupid, this sounds really stupid, you think I'm crazy, but I'm like, what would John do? And I think
he would continue
I correct myself.
Oh, is that true? I think that some of it may be because it's all, I feel very fortunate, maybe that's part of it, to have, I feel like I never take the opportunity for granted. The idea that, like, I get to express myself in ways that I never sort of dreamed that I would be able to do, and it, so I feel that the burden of that good fortune. And I also feel like I've worked a lot of shit jobs, and I've struggled a lot, and so I think you never lose, that person is always with you to let you know that you're not so great. You know, I've been fired enough to know that that person is still in me, and that I have to work harder and get better and those things, and so that's helpful. And it also helps to remind you of, like, you know, people always say, like, well, are you an activist? And I say, well, no, I'm not really an activist, but if there's some measure of activism in me, it's the quiet activism of living pleasantly. That sense of when you go to a restaurant, like, the person who's waiting tables, like, don't be a dick to them.
Oh.
And so it's that mentality, I feel like I try to infuse in my life and my work if I can.
That's what I think a lot of people admire about you, because you are that guy. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's good to see you again.
Likewise. If anything,
By the way, your apartment is lovely.
Thank you. You know,
I love what you've done with the drapes.
We try to pimp it. Actually, that's where all the action happens.
No. I understand. But 7 minutes in heaven. Get it.
I've been
around the block a couple of times.
Seven Iranian minutes is more like...
Well, that's a whole different thing. I get it.
Anything you want to, like, you feel like I missed in here, or that you want to definitely put in about the film? Or?
I hope they take it in the spirit of understanding, that it's seen as something that's an attempt to understand a terrible situation, not to definitively define it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
Take it, man.
It was so good to see you.
Good to see you, man. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.